Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Laura Shawver. I am a scientist and been working in biotech for a number of years. I'm currently the president and chief executive officer of Silverback Therapeutics, and I'm a member of the Stand Up to Cancer Scientific Advisory Committee. I'm also an ovarian cancer survivor, and based on my serving on the Scientific Advisory Committee, my career in biotech, and most importantly, as an ovarian cancer survivor, I served on the Joint Scientific Advisory Committee that selected the Ovarian Cancer Dream Team, and I'm very pleased to be leading today's Q&A. Today's conversation is a collaborative effort from the Ovarian Cancer Research Alliance, the National Ovarian Cancer Coalition, and Stand Up to Cancer. This Dream Team conducted a clinical trial, MAGENTA, or Making Genetic Testing Accessible, with the goal of making genetic testing for inherited cancer risk more accessible by shifting the entire genetic testing and counseling process into patients' homes. Today, we aim to have an open and honest conversation to talk about these barriers and challenges to providing robust genetic testing to assess ovarian and breast cancer risk, and to offer some solutions, such as the approach studied in the MAGENTA trial. To start off, I want to introduce you to Dr. Elizabeth Swisher, a gynecological oncologist and researcher at the University of Washington School of Medicine and co-leader of the Dream Team. I'm especially pleased to introduce you to Pamela. Pamela first participated in the MAGENTA trial in October of 2017, and in January of 2018, her results indicated that she was at increased risk for ovarian and breast cancer. Now, let's get to some questions and answers that we previously asked members of our ovarian cancer social media community. Dr. Swisher, let's start with you. Tell us why it's important for women with a family history of breast or ovarian cancer to get genetic counseling and counseling related to any increase in genetic risk for cancer.
Thank you, Laura. It's a pleasure to be here today. 20% of ovarian cancer, one out of five, is hereditary and therefore potentially preventable. Those cancers can be very deadly if diagnosed as a cancer, but quite preventable if we know a woman is at risk. So an individual who has a family history of breast and ovarian cancer may have a genetic risk of ovarian cancer themselves. Genetic testing is a way to find out. We don't treat people just on their family history anymore, which is how we used to do it, assuming that a family history puts somebody at risk. Now we can take that family history and then define who in the family is at risk and who is not, or if anybody in that family is at risk. Defining who is at risk is really important because then we can target prevention towards those women who are at risk, and women who are not at risk don't need increased surveillance or surgeries to prevent cancer.
Yes, and I definitely concur with that. It's been a number of years for myself when I was diagnosed with ovarian cancer, but I remember like yesterday, the big surgery and the chemotherapy, and if we can prevent women from having that experience, that's very, very important. And this whole trial to identify women at risk is so important. So a question from the community was, I've been diagnosed with ovarian cancer and I've been successfully treated. What's the benefit to me of being genetically tested now?
So there's two reasons that can help you as an ovarian cancer survivor. One is knowing you're at genetic risk of ovarian cancer can dramatically impact the treatments that are recommended for you if that cancer were to recur. Hopefully you're cured and that's never an issue, but if cancer is an issue for you, then it would dramatically affect treatment recommendations. That's number one. Number two, it can define whether you're at risk for other cancers. So if, for instance, you have a BRCA1 mutation, you are also at risk for breast cancer. If you have a mutation in MSH2, for example, you are also at risk for colon cancer. So we don't want you to survive one cancer to be sideswiped by another that could have been detected early or even prevented. Third, this information is really important for your family members. If your cancer is hereditary then your siblings, your children have a 50% chance of inheriting that risk. Equally, they have a 50% chance of not having that risk. So being able to identify people who are at risk in the family can be important for their medical care and recommendations.
Thank you. So Pamela, why were you interested in MAGENTA? And what is, could you tell us if you have a family history of either ovarian or breast cancer?
Yes, my family does have a history of several different kinds of cancer, including breast cancer in one of my grandmothers. But still, we were shocked when my big sister was diagnosed with ovarian cancer in 2016, and she became quite an advocate for prevention and early detection of ovarian cancer. So she is the person that recommended all of her female relatives participate in the MAGENTA trial. So my little sister, my cousin, and I all participated in the MAGENTA home genetic testing. And one thing I really loved about it was that it made the testing accessible directly to us. It did not require us to see a doctor and have doctor's orders to get that testing. And because of that, all three of us in the family were able to go through the MAGENTA testing process at the same time. And that gave us a lot of support to do it as a group and just made it kind of a fun family project to learn our own cancer risks.
Well, thank you for sharing that. So Dr. Swisher, why don't people get counseling and what have you observed as the barriers?
Well, the majority of genetic testing in this country is occurring after a cancer diagnosis. So if you think about it from a cancer prevention point of view, that's too late. What we need to do is identify people who are at risk and get them tested before they get cancer. So that's what Pamela's sister is trying to do for her relatives and her family. But we'd like to do that for Pamela's sister as well. Identify those women before they get cancer. So the first barrier is that people aren't even identified as being at risk. People either don't know their family history or doctors don't ask. Even if they do report their family history to the doctor, they're not referred for genetic testing. A genetic test is never ordered. So those are the first barriers. And in fact, a third of women who have hereditary ovarian cancer have no family history of breast or ovarian cancer. So even using family history as a screening tool is inadequate. Ultimately, one day we need to test every woman at the age of 30 for whether or not they have genetic risk of cancer. And then we won't be missing people just based on their family history. And why do people have no family history? Often it's because that risk can come from your father as well as your mother. Your father's probably not going to get breast cancer, and he's certainly not going to get ovarian cancer. So that can be passed down silently through the family. You get that risk, and then you're the first person with cancer. So offering testing to everybody needs to be simpler if we're going to do that. We need to simplify the process. So MAGENTA was one step to see, can we get testing to people in their home more easily with less barriers so that ultimately we can apply this widely across the population?
And I know that's what you were seeking to do with the MAGENTA study, but what's typically involved with testing and counseling? For example, if you pursue cancer risk genetic testing based on your healthcare provider's recommendation, what's typically involved?
So the classic paradigm is that your doctor refers you to a genetic counselor. You have to go in and make an in-person visit with that counselor or with a genetics doctor. They sit down and talk to you about what's involved with the testing, risks and benefits, educate you about the test, have you essentially sign consent. You get your blood drawn or provide a spit sample. Then you wait some amount of time and you come back and you make another appointment to get the results. And I think this is parallel with how we dealt with HIV testing in the 80s. It was very stigmatized. You had to, it was thought to be very special information. And so we put up these barriers where people had to come in to get that testing done. They had to be counseled, sign consent, come back in person. So a lot of people didn't get testing. that needed testing. And I think the same thing is happening with genetics is we've made it such special information that we've created these big hoops and barriers because we're concerned that patients won't have enough information. And so MAGENTA was really set up to test that. Is that really true? Could we deliver this in a simpler way without causing harm? Do we need to make patients have all that information before and after? Or perhaps we could do the testing with some kind of generalized education about what's happening, about what the test is for, and then provide more detailed counseling if patients have positive results on the back end.
Thank you. So Pamela, what was it like to go through the trial? Maybe you could describe for us a little bit about your experience.
Sure. Well, it was really easy and smooth. I was put into one of the groups that was given genetic counseling both before taking the test and when I received my results. And that was done over the telephone. Then the test kit was mailed to me at my home, and it included all the materials that I needed. The instructions were really easy to follow. I just had to spit into a little plastic container, close it up, put it in the return package, and pop it into my mailbox. So I never had to make any appointments or leave my house at all. It was just really convenient.
Thank you. So Dr. Swisher, how many mutations did you test for in the MAGENTA trial? And is that the usual number of mutations tested when ordered by healthcare providers?
So we used a panel of 19 genes that were just targeted to breast and ovarian cancer risk. Many of the cancer panels are a little bit bigger than that in terms of more genes, but we were just specifically targeting breast and ovarian cancer risk. Often the cancer panels will be more like 30 genes or so, which also include things targeted to pancreatic cancer and melanoma, for instance. But we were targeting just breast and ovarian cancer. Within those 19 genes, there are thousands and thousands of mutations because most people each have, you know, a unique mutation to their family. There are some mutations that are found over and over amongst different families, but we're testing for many, many thousands of mutations across those 19 genes.
Thank you. I think it's important to point out for the community that because of the number of mutations that you're testing for, this captures 20% of women with ovarian cancer. And it used to be the genetic panels only captured 10%. And now, based on what we've learned and the progress we've made, one in five women with ovarian cancer could be prevented. And anytime we can prevent a big surgery, big chemotherapy, of course, that is super important. Pamela, did you test positive for any of these mutations that are related to ovarian cancer and also breast cancer risk?
I did. Of the 19 genes that were tested, I was found to have one mutation that put me at significantly higher risk of breast cancer and colon cancer. Interestingly, my big sister, who was then fighting ovarian cancer, also tested positive for that same genetic mutation. So those were my results, one mutation, and that allowed me to then focus my efforts at prevention and early detection on those known high risks for me, breast and colon cancer, as well as ovarian, because of my first degree relative to my sister who had it.
Well, I imagine based on your sister's experience, you felt some anxiety going into the study. So how did you feel about going into the study, and how did you feel when you received your test results?
Well, I didn't have a lot of anxiety going into the study. Of course, I hoped that I would get a good result and not find any bad news. But as I said before, I knew my family history with a number of different cancers. So I had long believed that I probably had increased cancer risks. And I was just eager to find out exactly what they were. My first reaction was just an eagerness to share my results with my little sister and cousin who had been going through the test process with me and with my big sister. And once I had shared those results, it really took me some time to kind of digest my result and sort through what that increased risk meant to me. Ultimately, I would say I was disappointed, of course, that I had a genetic mutation that put me at some higher risk, but I was also very grateful to be aware of what my risks were so that I could follow up appropriately with my doctors.
Yes, that's very important. Dr. Swisher, how long does it typically take for people to receive their results?
So in the MAGENTA trial, because people were going through these processes and questionnaires and counseling, it took a little bit, I think, longer than it does outside. If you ordered the test, it's approximately about 4 weeks, so somewhere between 2 weeks and 6 weeks. I was curious to ask Pamela how the timing of her results coincided with that. Like, had your sister and your cousin already gotten their results when you got yours?
They had. They had been separated into a group of trial participants that did not get the genetic counseling before they took their test. So they received their test kits maybe 2 weeks before I received mine, and then also received their results that much sooner as well.
So that's a good segue back to the MAGENTA trial, and you had four arms of the study, and maybe you could talk about, you know, the design of the study, Dr. Swisher, and why it was important to group people in a specific way and what the results then told you.
So when we were setting up the trial, our first goal was to just see if we could safely deliver testing to women at home in their living room. And as we started to design the trial, we were asking the question, do we need to provide pre-test counseling? Do we need to provide post-test counseling? This is the paradigm. And do we need to have that be part of it? And we realized that paradigm had evolved without any real data to say that that was what was best for patients. And so as we designed the trial, we couldn't really figure out whether we needed to do that. And we said, well, let's answer that question then in the trial. So the one question is, do you need pre-test counseling? And another question is, do you need post-test counseling? So if we're going to answer that, then we needed four different combinations of pre- and post-test counseling. So the standard comparison arm were the people like Pamela who got pre-test counseling, did the spit kit, and then got post-test counseling in order to receive the results. That was standard. And then in the other arms, they either got no pre-test counseling, no post-test counseling, or neither pre-test nor post-test counseling. So those were the three other comparison arms. And we were looking at if patients 3 months after testing had more distress if they had less counseling. But it's notable that all patients who had a positive test, like Pamela, who had a mutation that increased the risk of cancer, then did get post-test counseling, even if they'd been assigned to an arm that didn't have counseling. Because we felt that it was important that somebody who had a positive result really be carefully given all the appropriate information after that test result. So those other three arms, all were equal in terms of they did not have increased distress, which was the outcome that we were testing. And then the other thing that we were looking at was, what about the completion rate? And what we found was the patients who we required pre-test counseling on had a lower completion rate. So the more barriers that we maybe put up, we weren't creating less distress, but we were creating it to be less likely that patients completed the test, got the kit back, got the results. And these are very motivated patients because they had already signed up for MAGENTA. And even within that context of super motivated patients who had signed up for a clinical trial to get testing, we decreased the completion rate by requiring pretest counseling.
Thank you. And Pamela spoke about what it was like to get her results and testing positive for mutations that put her at increased risk, and therefore being able to take some control and how to prevent the cancer from occurring in the first place. But Dr. Swisher, what's it mean for women in the trial who tested negative, meaning they don't have an increased genetic risk? And what do these participants learn about their individual inherited risk of cancer? And what does it mean for their ongoing personal health journey?
So people who have a very strong family history of cancer and test negative may still have an increased risk of cancer. And that really depends on their specific family and personal history. So the test results have, a negative test result has to be taken into context with the family history. A person who has no family history of cancer and test negative still has basically normal population risk of cancer. It doesn't mean they can't ever get cancer. It just means they don't have that increased hereditary risk. Somebody who has a strong family history may still have some hereditary risk, even with a negative test result, but much less so than if they had a positive test result. So that's just useful information, kind of like your cholesterol level. If you have a very high cholesterol level, that's going to put you at risk for heart disease. It doesn't mean you have heart disease. If you have a low cholesterol level, that doesn't mean you can't have a heart attack. It has to be taken into context with the rest of your risk factors.
Thank you. And, you know, for this MAGENTA trial, one of the important features was to provide, as you mentioned, that counseling for people that tested positive. But if somebody's not in the MAGENTA trial and they test positive, what kind of follow-up or support services are typically available?
So usually the patients who are being tested will be referred to a genetic counselor with a positive result, even if they hadn't already been hooked in with a genetic counselor who can provide information about resources in their community. We have a specialized breast and ovarian cancer prevention program that are for women who are at high risk because of familial or genetic results. And we try to develop a personalized prevention plan for those individuals based on, you know, what's appropriate for them and what their priorities are. So a 30-year-old woman, for instance, is going to have different set of priorities than a 50-year-old woman, also a different level of risk. So we try to personalize and tailor a prevention plan. And I would urge women who have a genetic risk of breast and ovarian cancer to seek out providers who can help them do that, to develop a personalized prevention plan that sits well with their priorities and will keep them safe and make this information really useful for them.
And we talked about the ongoing progress, particularly in the last few years. And now that we know that 1 in 5 ovarian cancer cases are preventable, if somebody had a test 5 years ago, should they be retested?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. It depends what they were tested for and when they were tested. So certainly 10 years ago, people were not having comprehensive testing for all these 19 genes, and retesting is worthwhile. 5 years ago, they may have had more comprehensive testing, and testing may not be worth doing again. So it's always worth keeping a copy of your test result. You should, if you get genetic testing, get a copy of that result and be able to look at that with your physician or with an expert who can sort out whether or not you had enough testing or should have consideration of more testing. And I just would like to add that a lot of people think that they've had genetic testing because they've done online genetics through what I would call like recreational genetics, so ancestry.com or 23andMe. These are, I'd say, fun and interesting, but should not be used for medical purposes and are not a cancer risk assessment tool. And so just because we were doing this online, it's quite different than some other online genetics information that you can participate in.
Yes, I think they even state that their results shouldn't be used to make any medical decision. So I'm glad that you brought that up. And one of the things about genetic testing, it always brings up a question around privacy. So our ovarian cancer community would really like to know what it means around privacy issues when you test positive for one of these mutations.
So genetic information within your healthcare is protected by HIPAA, as is all other medical information. There was a federal statute passed some years ago called GINA, which was the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act. And that applies to health insurance. Health insurance cannot charge you more or drop you because of genetic information. It doesn't apply necessarily to other types of discrimination that could occur, such as employment discrimination, disability insurance, and things like that. But really, there have been not reported cases of genetic information being used in that way. And as genetic information has become more and more mainstream for what we're doing in medical care, we all have genetic information of one kind or another. So it's really become, I think, less targeted that somebody has a genetic test result. Many of us have all kinds of different genetic test results. And really, honestly, your cholesterol is a genetic test result. It's just not labeled that way. It really reflects a hereditary risk. And so there's been very little discrimination, which is one reason that there hasn't been that much regulation around it. The argument against creating laws is if bad things aren't happening, then we shouldn't be legislating around it. I think it was really a huge concern of patients when this testing first became available, but it's become more and more mainstream, and it's really not being used against patients that we can tell.
Sure. And so, for example, our employer is not going to find out that we have a positive test for genetic, a positive genetic susceptibility test, right?
Not unless you put it on your Facebook page.
Right. Thank you. Although I guess it can be important for us to talk about our genetic risk, because that way we get the word out to more and more women about the potential to prevent ovarian cancer. This is very important. And Pamela, what did you do with your results? You mentioned that you talked to your sister and to your family, but maybe you could talk about what your next steps were and are, and please share your story.
Sure. My first step was to talk to a good friend of mine who is a doctor to recommend some doctors in my city that would best be able to address my increased cancer risk that I learned about through the testing. And the results from the testing also were available as like a printed report. So I brought to each of my doctor's appointments a copy of my MAGENTA test results so that the doctor had all the information that I had. And I first went to a gynecologist, and we ultimately decided to have BSO surgery to remove my ovaries and fallopian tubes. To me, that was the easy decision. The next decision came when I went to see a breast specialist about my increased breast cancer risk. And we discussed different options, including annual MRI, breast MRI, in addition to mammography, the possibility of taking preventive medications. But ultimately, we decided to do mastectomy surgery. So I had the mastectomy surgery about 5 weeks after my BSO surgery, and then a few months later had my colonoscopy, which I had been doing colonoscopies on a schedule since I was 40 years old. So I know I could never get my cancer risk down to zero, but I took those three steps, and I feel like those were reasonable steps to reduce my risk.
Thank you. And Dr. Swisher, in addition to those three steps that Pamela took, are there other preventative measures that women can take today, and how does her story relate to other women and the potential options that are available?
Yeah, I mean, I don't even think we have enough time today to talk about all the options that are available for cancer prevention if you're identified with high risk. And again, I just want to emphasize that we really want to personalize and tailor that to an individual patient, both for their genetic risk, but also for their age and their priorities. So I might, you know, have a young patient who has completed her childbearing, but doesn't yet, and is at high risk for ovarian cancer, and doesn't yet want to become menopausal, or is too young for us to really be recommending her having her ovaries out, and yet she's done with her childbearing and wants to maximize her cancer prevention, I might recommend to her to have her fallopian tubes removed, which we also had another Stand Up to Cancer study called WISP, which was addressing removing the fallopian tubes as a preventive measure for ovarian cancer. So that individual could potentially keep her hormones, reduce her ovarian cancer risk, and that would be quite individualized for her. And yet a patient who is menopausal, that wouldn't really make any sense to only remove her fallopian tubes and not remove her ovaries. So again, all this decision-making is quite individualized. Pamela, I think, was fortunate to find physicians that could help her work through those difficult decisions. But if you go to a surgeon and they just recommend surgery, then they're not giving you all your options. So just because you go to Jiffy Lube doesn't mean you have to have your oil changed. You really need to hear all the options, and then be able to make your decision. Then you're gonna be able to live with that decision without regrets.
Yeah, well, a lot of considerations for the people in your trial and women in general. How are you following up with the participants in your trial, and how are they learning about the MAGENTA outcomes?
So we, first of all, our primary outcome was to follow patients at 3 months, but we're also following patients at a year after they've completed their test results to look at kind of longer term outcomes and what they're doing with their screening, how they're sharing that information with their family, those types of things we're interested in, because perhaps in the short term counseling wasn't necessary to get the test results, but maybe it helps patients share the results or something like that. So that's why we want to follow up some other outcomes long-term. Ultimately, we want to share the results so that we can change the paradigm of genetic testing. Not that we want to blow up what's available, but that we want to give patients one more option for ways to access genetic testing. So our advocacy partners, including OCRA and NOCC and Stand Up to Cancer, have been helping us get the word out about the results, which is important for changing the paradigm. And I think we also want to look at what were we not able to do with MAGENTA. And one thing was we thought by making test results more easy to patients in their living room that we could potentially access patients who weren't otherwise getting genetic testing because they live in underserved communities. So rural communities, Black communities, they're not getting genetic testing at the same rates as other communities. And we did not really do a good job in MAGENTA accessing those patients, getting testing to those patients. So we're now gonna look at next steps of how do we make this broader available across. We don't want genomic advances to become a greater way of creating healthcare disparities. We want to reduce cancer risk across the board.
I'm glad that you're pursuing that follow-up then to get this genetic testing to underserved communities. It's very, very important. So we talked about how genetic testing can help with cancer prevention. Let's turn and talk about how genetic testing may help with treatment if one gets diagnosed with cancer. So Dr. Swisher, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so specifically for a lot of the genes that cause hereditary breast and ovarian cancer are in a category that work in DNA repair in the cells. And so they have overlapping functions, even though they're different genes. And if you have a hereditary risk in one of those genes, then the cancer that develops is more susceptible to a certain class of drugs called PARP inhibitors. And those are a recent class of drugs that have been approved in ovarian cancer and now breast cancer and now prostate cancer even. And those drugs can be very effective. So another part of our Stand Up to Cancer team was looking at trying to make these therapies more effective for women with ovarian cancer by figuring out which cancers are going to be susceptible to those therapies, even beyond the hereditary ones. Who are the best patients to use those therapies for, and how can those therapies be combined with other drugs to be even more effective? So there's a lot of work in that area, and that also includes even adding in immunotherapy as a component to these PARP inhibitors.
Thank you. And we all have friends and family members that have had hysterectomies. So if people have had a hysterectomy, should they still get genetically tested?
Yeah, so the hysterectomy may protect you against uterine cancer. It may or may not protect you against ovarian cancer, depending whether the ovaries and the fallopian tubes were removed with that hysterectomy. So knowing really whether or not you have your ovaries is really important after you've had a hysterectomy. But the genetic testing is important even if you don't have that organ, because it tells you what cancers you are at risk for, which may go beyond a uterine cancer, for example. And secondly, it's going to inform other family members who may also be at risk. So unless you've had your colon removed, both breasts removed, your ovaries and your uterus removed, it would be hard to remove everything that you might be at risk for. So genetic testing is probably still going to be useful for you.
Yes, I think it's important to get across that, again, going back to prevention is the best way to treat cancer, never get it in the first place. The more people that get genetic testing, and important to point out that simple procedures like hysterectomy do not, typically don't reduce your risk. So Pamela, as you reflect back on the MAGENTA trial, what are your thoughts about it, and how are you feeling now?
I am so grateful that I was included in the MAGENTA trial, and I do want to thank both of you for your role in it. It was easy to do the testing. It was something that my sister ultimately lost her battle with ovarian cancer, but I feel like she probably saved my life with her advocacy for getting into this MAGENTA testing study and just being aware of some of the things I could do in the way of prevention and early detection. So my feelings about the MAGENTA study are very positive.
I'm very sorry to hear about your sister. I know that this is, that's very, very difficult. And of course, one of the things the MAGENTA trial is seeking to help with is this prevention. Maybe Dr. Swisher, you could talk a little bit about, you know, what it means for family members and how to get the word out, and how broadly we should really consider genetic testing for women. Is it just women with a family history? Is it all of us? How do we think about this?
That's a good question, and I'm going to get to it, but I just first want to say thank you to Pamela because for participating not only in MAGENTA, but also for sharing your story, because that's really how we do get the word out to people. And participating in a clinical trial is so important for how we can advance care for everyone else. So your sister gave you this information, but you're paying it back bigger. And so I really do appreciate that.
Thank you.
In terms of getting who should be tested, I really do believe that we need to be doing population testing. If we're going to capture all patients with hereditary risk before they get cancer, we really need to be doing testing on a large scale. And there have been cost-effective analysis studies that show that it actually is cost-effective now that DNA sequencing and genetic testing has gotten so much cheaper that it's cost-effective to test everybody. You can get, a comprehensive panel of testing for all the cancer risk genes for $249. That's, not more than a mammogram. Like, to have everybody have a test that one time during their lifetime would identify the people who are at high risk, and then we could, and then we could prevent a lot of cancers, and that actually would be cost effective. So ultimately, that's what we need to move towards. One problem with our fractured medical system is that there isn't really a reward for prevention and long-term healthcare, because everybody only is on a healthcare plan on an average of 2 years. So health insurance wants to basically save money now and not think about who's going to get cancer down the road. So the denial of coverage for genetic testing is just wide and absurd, and the hoops that they make you jump through. So some insurance companies make you go see an MD and not a counselor in order to get the test, Medicare being one of them, because the more hoops that they create, the less tests will get done and the less it will cost them. So we need to break down those barriers at the insurance and the societal level. And really, ultimately, we should just get testing to everybody.
I think that's so important. I would also like to add my vote about the importance of population testing, because we could certainly not just prevent cancers, but I'd like to go back to how it could impact if one does get diagnosed with ovarian cancer or breast cancer or colon cancer or some of these others that are associated with genetic alterations where there are now treatment options. So maybe Dr. Swisher, you could again talk about, the new treatments, since you were involved with the development of these, some of the new treatments, some of the clinical trials that might be available to people. Let's talk a little bit about that before we wrap up.
So two big areas where hereditary cancers really influence treatment of ovarian and other gynecologic cancers. One is in the PARP inhibitor arena that I mentioned. And more recently, PARP inhibitors have been approved in the frontline treatment for ovarian cancer. So we started treating patients that had recurrent ovarian cancer. Now it's part of primary therapy and becoming standardized. But there are patients that have much more benefit than other patients, even though it's pretty widely approved. So knowing what your benefit is, can relate to your hereditary testing, and that might make it more worthwhile for you to take these drugs potentially, for a period of time. So PARP inhibitors are oral drugs, and we often are giving them in what we call maintenance settings, which means you get your chemotherapy, you get the cancer treated, you're in remission, and then you go on this oral drug for a period of some years afterwards to try to cement that remission and make it permanent and turn, what's a remission into really a long-term cure. So another area where it's important is in immunotherapy. Some of the hereditary cancers are associated with DNA alterations that make those cancers more susceptible to immunotherapy. And in that setting, cancers that are associated with Lynch syndrome, which is a genetic risk of ovarian, uterine, colon cancer, and some other cancers, those patients have a higher response rate to immunotherapy than they do to chemotherapy. So we wouldn't want to be giving somebody really toxic chemotherapy when they're going to have a better response to a less toxic immunotherapy. So all that is just really, I think, revolutionizing how we treat cancer patients. And again, personalization is so important. I talked about personalization for cancer prevention, but personalization for cancer treatment is equally important. Let's treat the Achilles heel of any individual cancer.
Absolutely. And we all know that Stand Up to Cancer is sponsoring quite a number of clinical trials where people might benefit. So if you're diagnosed with cancer today, ask your doctor about genetic testing. Ask your doctor about what are the treatments that are right for me, and ask your doctor about clinical trials. So this session has been very important. I've learned a lot. It's been informative for me. I hope it has been for you at home as well. Before we leave, I want to reflect on some of the important results from the MAGENTA clinical trial. Results have shown that genetic testing can be provided remotely, and that genetic counseling before and after testing can be provided remotely without causing increased distress to patients. With these findings, it seems that remote approaches might be effective in helping to break down barriers to access genetic testing and expand opportunities to reduce cancer care, especially in this COVID-19 era, where we even have more barriers to routine care and cancer care than ever. And with the organizations such as Ovarian Cancer Research Alliance, National Ovarian Cancer Coalition, and Stand Up to Cancer, more people are understanding the importance of understanding their own health risks and have the information needed for a productive discussion with our healthcare providers. Thank you, Dr. Swisher, for your sharing your important work. Pamela, thank you so very much for participating and sharing your important story. Thank you very much for taking the time to watch.